Hear ye, hear ye. The 12th president of Livingstone College, Dr. Jimmy R. Jenkins, Sr., presiding. Please be seated. Good morning. Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. At this juncture in the history of Livingstone College, we come before you this morning with a ritual that is old as the institution and one that is sacred to our institution. I'm proud as the 12th president to be able to preside over this event this evening, this morning. Goodbyes are always hard.
How do I say goodbye to what we have?
As I stand here at what will be my last time presiding over a fall convocation at Livingstone College as president, the sentiment is bittersweet. While I look forward to spending more time with my family and my lovely wife, your First Lady, Dr. Felice Moore Jenkins, would you please stand so we can recognize you? I will miss the experiences of the past 16 years serving as your president. I can only hope and believe that the work I've done will speak for me, and that I have fully and satisfactorily executed the duties of my assignment with excellence, forging a smoother path toward continued success for the next great leader of this institution. Thank you to the Board of Trustees for allowing me the freedom and flexibility to lead this institution with transformative policies and principles. Thank you for the administration, faculty, and staff for supporting me throughout the years, for giving life to my vision, and for being as determined as I am help this college live up to its historical mantra as the Harvard of the South. Thank you, parents, for entrusting us with your sons and daughters to prepare them to command their rightful place in a global society. And thank you for our alumni, for it is you who are the ambassadors for this institution in your respective areas. Your pride for your alma mater is a positive reflection of your experience here that attracts others to come. So instead of saying goodbye to Livingstone College, I would rather say hello to a new chapter in my life called retirement. So without further ado, I say it this last time, I am Dr. Jimmy R. Jenkins, Sr., the 12th president and retiring president of Livingstone College. And on behalf of the Board of Trustees, First Lady Dr. Felice Moore Jenkins, and the entire Livingstone College family, welcome to our 2022 fall convocation. To our distinguished president, to our distinguished chairman of the Board of Trustees, Bishop Monroe, who is our chairman, and I'm proud to have served with him in so many ways. We've been able to make strides that I'm very proud of. And so I open up this fall convocation with giving you these goodbye statements. So if you will please stand for the singing of the national anthem, followed by the singing of the Negro National Anthem, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Oh,
will now have the scripture reading by the Reverend Dr. Dwayne Walker, pastor of Little Rock AME Zion Church in Charlotte, and a member of the Board of Livingstone College Board of Trustees. He will be followed by prayer by Bishop Hilliard Dogby of Accra, Ghana, presiding prelate of the West Africa Episcopal District and a member of the Board of Trustees.
Thank you, Dr. Jenkins. Good morning. From the New Testament epistle written by Peter, 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning with verse 1, from the New King James Version, this is what it says. Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Coming to him as to a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious, you also, as living stones, are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is also contained in the scripture, "Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. Therefore, to you who believe, he is precious, but to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense. They stumble, being disobedient to the word, to which they also were appointed. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God shall stand forever.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Beloved, let us pray. Gracious God, we come before your throne of grace, trusting not in our own goodness, but in your righteousness. Lord, we've come to say thank you. We've come to say thank you for bringing us many mighty ways. We've come to say thank you for sustaining and guiding this institution. We've come to say thank you for the leadership of this institution. We've come to say thank you for the administration, for the staff, and for the students of this institution. Because it is by thy grace that we are here gathered this morning. So, Lord, we invoke your divine presence upon our gathering, that you will ennoble every act and action of ours this morning, that ultimately glory will come unto you. We thank you for the life of President Jenkins, and for sustaining and guiding him and his family over the years, even as they provided leadership for this institution. Even as he transitions, Lord, we pray for your guidance over his life, that you strengthen him in every good way, that he will continue to be a blessing unto many. Bless the administration. Bless the incoming president. And Lord, even as we go through this process of transition, your glory will be made manifest. Your power will be present. And your grace will be sufficient. Even as you bind us together and lead us on into the new heights that you have reserved for us. We commit the board of trustees unto you. Commit the administration unto you. We commit the entire student body unto you, particularly the freshmen. Lord, you have brought them this far. You have brought them through many a pain and many a toil and many a sweat. And now they are ready to move on to new heights. In the midst of their weakness, Lord, strengthen them. In the midst of their frustration, Lord, grant them the grace to keep their focus, that they will not stray from the presence, nor from the focus for which you brought them here. That your purpose for their life will also be accomplished. Lord, be our guide, we pray you. Be our guide, we pray you. Strengthen us, we pray you. And let the power of your grace and your presence guide us through this process of convocation this morning and throughout the year. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated, and if you haven't gotten up yet, you can stay down there. To President Jenkins, members of the Board of Trustees, faculty and staff, freshman class, 2026, our honored guests, all who assembled, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You might not be able to see my name on the program. It's in small print. It's so small, I can't see it. But I'm grateful to God to stand before you today as the chairman of the Board of Trustees and to greet you and to say to you that it is important that you embrace every moment that God gives you. Some years ago, I spoke to the graduating class, and my subject to them was, what matters most is what happens next. And let me also say to you that life comes at you fast. During the Board of Trustees meeting the other night, yesterday morning, I was able to reflect on my experience at Livingstone College. I came here as a poor young boy from a little small town in the eastern part of North Carolina, in a section of the town called the Black Bottom. During an opportunity that I had to speak with CEOs from Truist Bank, I told them the story of my coming to Livingstone as a poor young boy in the Black Bottom. Little town, you know, it's already at the bottom. And I came from the lowest part of that bottom. I told them that story because of the mission of HBCUs who take those persons who may not have been considered persons to go anywhere or even do anything. And I told them that story because I think it's important for you to take the opportunity that has been given to you to succeed, to do what you've never done before, to go where you've never gone before. And as I sit and talk with those gentlemen, CEO, Truth Band, and I say, you know what? HBCUs take people like me and help them get to be leaders in this country. I said, now I sit as the chairman of the Board of Trustees. Don't make a mistake about it. Life comes at you fast. Before you know it, you'll be my age. I will celebrate 50 years next year, a member of the Golden Class. I hope I make it there. And it won't be long, my brothers and sisters, because what matters most is what happens next. Tomorrow's coming, but always remember, there's a next. Trouble comes, but always understand, there is a next. Trials come, but even you go through trials, there is a next. Victory comes, but even in victory, there is a next. Embrace the time and set your life, set your priorities for the future. For matter of fact, begin today to live in the future. God bless you.
And now we will hear, starting with the Reverend Dr. Johnny P. Henderson, President of the Faculty Assembly, and then Mr. Michael Gilliard, the 94th Essex Student Government Association President, and in the absence of Mr. and Miss Livingstone, who are competing in the 37th annual competition of Black College Queens in Atlanta, Georgia right now. We will hear from Miss Denia Coleman, Miss Oak, and Mr. Darian Graham, Mr. Maple.
To the 12th President, Dr. Jimmy R. Jenkins, Sr., to the First Lady, Dr. Felice Moore Jenkins and family, to the Senior Bishop, and to the Board of Trustees and Bishops, to the alumni, to the senior administration, to the faculty, and to the staff, to the 94th SGA President Michael Gilyard, to the student body, to the class of 2026, the freshman class, to the graduating seniors to come. To all of the parents and to our special guests, Dr. Otis Moss III, to presiding elders, missionary supervisors, pastors, ministers, family, loved ones who have come for this great convocation 2022. And to the hardest working faculty in academia, we thank you for what you have done. Will you please stand to our new faculty that have come? You stand, faculty. Dr. Colin Pillay, Dr. Nisha Singh, Dr. Sharma, Dr. Sharif Muhammad, to the Criminal Justice Department, Chef Carl Brown and Chef Elizabeth Marquez, Ms. Gracie Rogers, Dr. Crawley, and Dr. Penn for taking our students and volunteering them, 8 Carolina Panthers, 8 Charlotte Hornets games, to Dr. Reed, to the Criminal Justice Department, Criminology, Social Work, to those of our faculty that have gone on and gained other degrees, Jason Gardner, who has completed a second master's and is working on his PhD at Liberty University. And to all of our faculty, we thank you for the hard work that you do. Tasha, my cuz, Dr. Natasha Barnes, and for all that you do, my faculty, I thank you for your support as your faculty assembly president. And to this distinguished SGA body and the graduating seniors and class of 2026, I was thinking about what I could say in closing. Yesterday, I was listening to reports given the Board of Trustees retreat, and I listened to one person in the crowd who said something had been resonating in his spirit, a song that he just seemed like it couldn't leave him. And the song was entitled, "Go Out and Tell Your Story." Bishop George Washington Carver Walker said it was just stirring in his spirit, and something hit me. I like Bishop Proctor, I tried to go to sleep. That song kept resonating in my spirit. And I had to go to Google. Y'all know anything about Google? And I Googled it on my phone and I had to pull it up. And Brian Stokes Mitchell said, "Go out and tell your story. Go out Our justice was our banner, and our justice was denied. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. And say to those who blame us for the way we chose to fight, for sometimes there are battles, can I get a witness, that are more than black and white. And I could not put down my sword when justice was my right. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. Go out and tell our story to our sons and our daughters. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. And tell them in our struggles, we were not the only ones. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. Your sword can be a sermon. Can I get a witness? Or the power of the pen. Teach every child to raise his voice. And then my brothers, come on, my brothers and sisters, can I get any witnesses out there? And then will justice be demanded of 10 million righteous men? Make them hear you. When they hear you, when they hear you, I'll be there near you again. Maybe that's not in your pew, but go out and tell your story. Let it echo far and wide. Make them hear you. As I said, maybe that's not in your pew, but maybe you may know this. I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, and Jesus, his precious love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies, can I get a witness, my longings as nothing else can do. Oh, I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. Maybe that's not in your pew, but come on, go with me. Blessed assurance. Somebody said, Jesus is mine. Hallelujah. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. I'm glad about it. Are you glad about it? I'm an heir of salvation. Purchase of God. I'm born of his spirit, washed in his blood. I don't know about you, but this is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. And maybe that don't help you, but one more thing, perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels are descending, rain from above. I said, echoes, can I get a witness? Echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Go out and tell your story. Let it echo. Amen. Why? Tell your story. You got to tell your story. Class of 2026, you got to tell your story. Graduating class, bishops, you got to tell your story, because somebody, can I get a witness, wants to know about your story. God bless you.
Hallelujah.
Good morning.
Hallelujah.
To the 12th president of Livingstone College, Dr. Jimmy R. Jenkins, Sr., want to thank you for what you've done. To the 12 President's First Lady, excuse me, we want to also thank you for what you've done for Livingstone College as well. To the Board of Bishops, we want to thank you for keeping us going. To the Board of Trustees, we want to thank you for keeping us in line. To my administration, I want to thank you all for your constant support as you keep me in line and help me with my programming and scheduling. I won't be before you long. I was trying to figure out what I should say to you all as freshmen. Coming into my freshman year, I didn't know how college was going to work out. But I'm going to backtrack a little bit. I was on TikTok the other night. It had to be about 12, 11. And I was like, you know, I still don't know what to say to them. So I'm going to just Google different motivational quotes to see what I can make out of it. But TikTok came through. It showed two suitcases on the floor. And one suitcase was really nice and brand new. And another suitcase showed a little bit of wear and tear. And one thing that they stated where they were was in the baggage claim section at the airport. Oftentimes in life, we all come with a little baggage with us. And I had to realize it's not the baggage all the time. Sometimes it can be how we carry it. When I look back to my first day stepping foot on Livingstone College in the Bridge program in 2019, I remember coming through with 70 or 60 students. And I realized one thing throughout my whole time in Bridge. I kept saying, how did I get here? And I questioned myself, what did I not do right? But sometimes I had to, one thing I had to realize was, it's not always gonna make sense. And so, with that being said, I just thank God for what I had to go through in order to get to where I am today. Because without that, I would have never appreciated the things that he was doing, but I want to first thank him for what he's already done. So in this time, class of 2026, I want you to thank God in advance for what you know he's going to do. Because if he doesn't do anything, he's not going to leave us astray. Thank you. My name is Michael Gilliard, and I'm the 94th Student Government Association President.
That's what we mean when we say take our students where they are, take them where they need to be, so they can command their rightful place in the global society. Let's give Michael Gilliard another hand.
Change your perspective and take control. Greetings, Blue Bear family. I am Danaya Coleman, a business administration scholar, sophomore, hailing from Farrell, Pennsylvania. I stand on the platform of self-discipline and focus.
You are the result of everything that you become. Grand Rising Blue Bear family, my name is Darion Graham, hailing all the way from Chicago, Illinois. I'm a junior business administration scholar, and I firmly stand on the platform of live simply so others can simply live. And welcome to today's convocation.
Thank you.
Now at this time, I want to call on Dr. State Alexander, the Executive Assistant to the President and the Vice President of Communications and Public Relations, who will come forward to recognize our special guest.
Good morning again. We have some persons who have committed themselves fully, have sacrificed much to be the leaders of this institution, our Board of Trustees. Will you join me in a round of applause as they stand? Let's give them a Blue Bear round of applause. A special recognition today for Bishop George W.C. Walker, Trustee Emeritus and honorably retired Senior Bishop of the AME Zion Church. Please, sir, would you stand and receive our thanks for your service and contribution. There he is. Perfect timing, Bishop Walker. Continue standing. Thank you, sir. Thank you. I'd like to ask all clergy, if you would please stand where you are. Thank you, sir, ladies and gentlemen. It's always a great honor and pleasure for me to present and introduce the First Lady of Livingstone College, Dr. Felice Moore Jenkins, Madam First Lady of our 12th president. Will you stand with members of your family? Let us thank you for your service for 16 years with our beloved 12th president. And now, let us welcome with a special Blue Bear applause, Mrs. Jackie Davis, and welcome her as the 13th First Lady of Livingstone College. The children of Dr. Davis are here with us. Would you all please stand? And his aunt, Mrs. Phyllis Bowman. Would you stand, ma'am? Thank you. I'd like to ask again the distinguished faculty of Livingstone College to stand and receive our thanks for your work and contribution to the development of our students. Please stand, ladies. We appreciate you so much. And speaking of distinguished faculty, Ms. Teresa Moore Mitchell, director of the Livingstone College Choir, will lead our choir in a historic concert with the choir of Catawba College on Sunday, October 2nd at 4 p.m. This concert will be held on the Catawba campus in their chapel. It's a free concert, and you're invited. This is the first time in 30 years or more that the two choirs from our colleges have performed on the same program to share Livingstone's music. I'd like to all alumni present to please stand. I want to recognize Mr. Sam Brown, a Livingstone alum and managing editor of the Star of Zion. Sir, please stand. Elected officials present, please stand. Ms. Dee Dee Wright. Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. From East Pencil. Ms. Dee Dee Wright of the West End Coalition. I've heard that she was going to be with us today. Don't see her. There she is. Welcome, Dee Dee. I'd like to welcome Dr. Latricia Hill Cadet, CEO of Ottendorf Laboratories. Ottendorf has been instrumental in our COVID efforts, so thank you, madam, for your work. Mayor Pro Tem of East Spencer, Sean Rush. Sean just stood. Stand again, Sean, if you would. I'd like to welcome Dr. Annie Gavin, wife of Dr. Gavin, James Gavin. Would you stand, madam? There she is, an alum of Livingstone College. We'd like to thank, and with a standing ovation, the soon-to-be graduating class of 2023. Let's give them a big round of applause. So they can go out and command their rightful place and the Global Society. And finally, we'd like to thank you and the members of the Convocation Committee for their hard work and for your prayers in support of Livingstone College and sharing this wonderful experience with us today. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Alexander. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I have the distinct honor of introducing our speaker for this occasion. The Reverend Dr. Otis Moss III is a preacher, author, producer, and activist. He has served as pastor of Trinity United Church of Christ in Chicago, Illinois since 2008. But it was his award-winning documentary short film about his grandfather that catapulted him into the national spotlight. The film Otis Dream, which debuted during the 2020 election to encourage people to vote, and retells the story of Dr. Moss's grandfather, Otis Moss Sr., in 1946, he walked for three different polling places, a total of 18 miles, only to be denied the right to vote. His grandfather died before he could ever vote. But Dr. Otis's father picked up the baton and fought alongside Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. for civil rights and social justice. And now the baton has been passed to Dr. Moss, our speaker today. Dr. Moss preaches the black theology of that unapologetically calls attention to the problems of mass incarceration, environmental justice, and economic inequality. He believes that love and justice are inseparable in the foundation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. He is a native of Cleveland, Ohio. He is an honor graduate of Morehouse College, earned a Master's of Divinity from Yale Divinity School, and received his Doctor of Ministry degree from Chicago Theological Seminary. He is the author of the book Blue Note Preaching in a Post-Soul World, Finding Hope in an Age of Despair, and is a professor at Mercer University's McAfee School of Theology. In 2012, he founded Unashamed Media Group, a faith-based social justice production company that curates stories to inspire the heart and challenge crippling structures. It was his company that produced the short film, Otis the Dream, that has won 8 awards, including Best Documentary Short. It is being adapted for a feature long length film. Dr. Moss and his wife, the former Monica Brown, have 2 children. Ladies and gentlemen, give a thunderous Blue Bear applause to Dr. Otis Moss III, our speaker for this occasion.
First, I want to take this opportunity to thank the president of this great institution for your work and for your witness and for this opportunity to be with you, and to the class of 2026. It is an honor to have this opportunity to be able to share with you on this day. To the trustees of this institution, to the faculty, but all who labor here in this space, I'm grateful for this opportunity to be able to share. Scripture was read earlier from 1 Peter, where it states, you are a chosen generation. And you are a chosen. Another translation could be, you are a gifted generation. Another translation could be, you are a blessed generation. You are a generation that will open doors that have been shut for decades and decades. But we are grateful I simply want to offer this idea for this chosen generation, that you have nothing to lose. You are your ancestors' wildest dreams, our nation's hope, and at the same time, our nation's fear. Because if you choose to be who God wants you to be, there will be those who will celebrate, and there will be others who will place hurdles in front of you to ensure that you do not reach the capacity that God has already placed within your spirit. You are the chosen generation. You are a blessed generation. You are a gifted generation. If I may share a simple story, growing up in Cleveland, Ohio, every year, my godfather, by the name of Alan Warren, would take myself and my godbrother to the circus, not just any circus, but the Barnum and Bailey three-ring circus, Bishop Moore. We loved going to the circus. I enjoyed going to the circus every single year. I loved everything about the circus. I loved the lions, the tigers, the bears, oh my. I loved everything about the circus. I loved that clown car where there seemed like 11 people would come out of a little small car. I loved the trapeze artists. I loved the animals. I loved looking at the bears. I was amazed by them. But there was one particular animal that I loved looking at because it was so majestic and powerful. Those were the elephants. The elephants were so large and powerful, but yet the elephant would listen to a little man with a whip and a chair. It made no sense to me why that which has so much power and authority would listen to somebody so small and does not have as much strength as they do. I was always worried every time we went to this circus, and that since we had good seats, I was worried that something would happen, specifically an elephant coup d'etat would take place, especially where we were sitting, because these elephants were majestic, they had power, they had authority. I was afraid of an elephant revolution. But my godfather told me, you don't have to worry about an elephant revolution. Because before these elephants came to be presented in front of you right now, they were trained to be in the position that they are. They placed chains around their neck, and they made sure that there was a chain roughly in 12 feet in length. So the elephant would think that the limitation on his possibility was the chain around his neck. When the elephant reached a certain age and was emancipated from the physical chains, they still function as if they had chains around their neck because they had mental chains upon their mind. He said, you never have to worry about these elephants because these elephants will operate out of a particular limitation that someone else has placed upon their mind. He said, the elephant that you have to worry about is the elephant that realizes I ain't got nothing to lose. Because when the elephant realizes that your whip cannot stop me, your chair cannot hurt me, then there's a revolution that's about to take place. And I say to Livingstone right now, there has been emancipation upon us physically, but it's time right now, you, the chosen generation, to take off the chains around your mind and your spirit, because there is nothing that can stop you. There may be others that put hurdles in front of you. They may try to trip you up, but I'm here to let you know that you have nothing to lose. You are your ancestors' wildest dreams and this nation's hope, and at the same time, this nation's fear. Do you not know that there are people that want to keep you within a particular box to limit your possibility? They are fearful of you. They are scared about this school, for what will be produced by the students who sit in these chairs. But the moment you decide to live up to who God calls you to be, a revolution is about to take place here in Salisbury, North Carolina, that will transform this nation into something that we never believed it could be. You are your ancestors.
ancestors' wildest dreams and this nation's hope and this nation's fear at the same time. You enter into a legacy. Don't you ever think that you're sitting here in these chairs by yourself. Don't you know you came through these doors because somebody prayed for you in the morning and somebody prayed for you at night. Don't ever think that you did it by yourself. Every once in a while, you ought to thank your big mama, your grandmama, and those elders who prayed for you before you entered these doors. This is a freedom institution. It was built as a result of people who would not be denied their ability to thrive, even though this nation said they were only 3/5 of a human being. Don't you know the AME Zion Church is a freedom institution? And there were terrorists in the land who did not want Livingstone to exist, but by the grace of God, men and women said, we hold on to God's unchanging hand and put a book under the other hand, and we shall move forward and not be miseducated by people who want to keep us limited in what we can do. They fear you. They fear you because you are black made by God's grace. They fear you because everything black people do, we always do it with a little swagger and extra flavor. Don't you know we extra in everything we do? When we find leftovers, we make gumbo. When we find pieces of cloth, we make a quilt. We take used instruments and make jazz. We take sorrow songs and make the blues. We take creative chords and make the gospel. We take polyrhythms and make R&B. We take bass grooves and make funk music. We take tune turntables and a microphone and make hip-hop. And if you got a beat machine, you may even make some trap music in the process. I'm here to let you know we do everything with flavor. America cannot be America without you. We built this nation. You need to walk around not with your head hanging low, but know that the soil that we walk upon, the nation that we live in, was built by you. Even though we're on stolen land, you are your ancestors' wildest dream. There is nothing you cannot do. You will learn here at Livingstone that as a person of African descent, you sailed the seas before Europe created a boat. You charted stars before the Greeks knew constellations. You studied medicine before Rome was a nation. Our ancestors wrote the Torah, sang the Psalms, and preached with the prophets. For those who may be confused, that may even still think that Jesus came from Sweden, I want to let you know that when God told Joseph and Mary to hide Jesus, they said, don't go to Rome, don't go to Germany, don't go to Sweden. Hide my child down in Africa called Egypt, because it's easier to hide among camouflage. In other words, it's easier to hide at Livingstone than it is at Duke University. I've got to hide around people who look just like me. There is power being a part of an HBCU. You are God's gift. And to the class of 2023. Now I know when you walk across the stage, you're gonna be excited. And I have to say, Mr. President, that I know that you will have someone, the Dean of Academic Affairs, who will stand and tell everybody, please hold your applause until the entire class of 2023 has received their degree, and we will celebrate for them. But they forget that every year Big Mama shows up. And when she shows up, she says, I've been praying too long. I'm gonna shout for my child, for what my child has done. The only institution that can go from pomp and circumstance to a Pentecostal revival meeting within 3 seconds. At an HBCU, You are the chosen generation. You are the blessed generation. You are a gifted generation. Do not allow other people to define who you can be and what you can be. If you listen to others who try to whisper in your ears, they will tell you there's only certain things that you can do, that there's a ceiling upon your limitations in terms of the possibilities in your life. But I am here to let you know that you do not have any possibilities made by humanity. God has already placed some things in your spirit. I love to tell students, especially those in high school who feel that they only have athletic prowess. I say, hey, if you can play basketball, you should be able to bust out physics. They always look at me strange. I said, well, let me break it down so you understand what I'm trying to say. If you can take a spherical object that is roughly 27 inches in circumference and bounce it down the spatial dimensions of a court that is 90 feet long by 54 feet wide, moving roughly 8 to 10 miles down the spatial dimensions of that court that is 90 feet long by 54 feet wide, and then jump 35 inches vertically, 7 feet horizontally, up to a basket that is 10 feet high, and then dunk it, you are physics in motion. But if you allow someone else to define your existence, you will never realize the power that is already in you. We have a legacy. And in the words of Jay-Z, remind yourself, nobody built like you. You design yourself. You have to understand that you have a gift inside of you. So I say to you, the class of 2026, walk with swagger. Study with power. Dream with authority. You are students of Livingstone. You are scholars and poets and writers and preachers, activists and educators, engineers and doctors, lawyers, investors, politicians and business leaders, marketeers, scientists, biologists, managers, filmmakers, actors, producers, musicians, and agents. You have the authority. And when that year of 2026 comes about, some of you will graduate cum laude, and some of you will graduate magna cum laude, some of you will graduate summa cum laude, but a whole lot of us graduated thank you Lord. And however you walk across that stage, give God praise that you are the chosen generation. You are the gifted generation. You are the blessed generation. My name is Otis Moss. I'm done. Peace. I'm out.
I think it's appropriate. I think we're having church here this morning. We're having church here this morning. I'm proud to be able to say that. Dr. Moss, thank you for your words of wisdom today. You were the excellent selection for this occasion. And we thank you for the words that you shared with us today. Thank you. At this time, we will have another selection from the Livingstone College Choir, directed by Mrs. Teresa Moore Mitchell, featuring soloist and freshman Mr. Kayon Courtney.
Things eternal and hold to God's unchanging hand. forsaken, or still more closely to him cling. Oh, you better hold, yeah. Oh, hold, yeah, yeah. Build your hopes on things in turn.
Dr. Moss, would you please join me at the podium? I would like to present you with the Livingstone College President's Award. This award is reserved for those who have demonstrated character and accomplishments in their respective line of work and study. As a third-generation warrior, you have exemplified a respect for your past in honoring the legacy of your grandfather and father with tenacity to change the future for the next generation. Please keep pushing forward. It's my honor to present to you the President's Award, the highest award that this institution can give.
Told me I had to make a statement. So again, I thank Livingstone for your gifts in terms of the student body, this faculty. You are a treasure in our nation. Know that you are on sacred ground, and I thank you for the opportunity to be here in this space to witness the birth of greatness in the class of 2026. Thank you.
At this time, we will begin our induction ceremony. But first, let me recognize our seniors. Seniors who are graduating, thank you and congratulations on your... I want to say you have persevered and persisted, and with the finish line and on the horizon, you will be especially commended, because halfway through your college years, your matriculation was interrupted by a global pandemic like we have never seen before. Despite the challenges, you kept the faith, you endured the race, and your reward is soon to come. Congratulations to the senior class. Bishop Monroe, we will now begin the ceremony for the induction of the freshmen into this class. The induction ceremony represents a rite of passage for our freshman students into the collegiate experience. We welcome the freshmen, the class of 2026, and their parents who may be in the audience and who will watch if not later, in our YouTube channel. Dr. Orlando Lewis, Vice President for Student Affairs, will now join me at the podium and to begin the ceremony.
Mr. President, today we have come to present to this body young men and women who have indicated that they have no intentions of cursing the darkness. They come seeking light. We have told them of a world filled with strife, of wars and rumors of wars, of disease, of drugs, of promiscuity, and of man's inhumanity to man. We have told them about racism and about greed. We have told them that if this journey over the next 4 years is to have meaning and value, they must acquire special skills and must understand that a little knowledge is a dangerous thing. Mr. President, we have told them that many have taken a path they now embark upon, only to fall by the wayside from peer pressure, lack of determination, a lack of maturity, and an unwillingness to change. George Santayana told us that they who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it. Today, 260 sit before us, set to make the journey of so many others before them. The Bible tells us that the victory is not given to the swift nor to the strong, but those who endure to the end. How many of these we have come to honor today will endure to the end and gain the victory? I now want each freshman to look to the right of you and say to your classmate, I plan to run this race with patience. What about you? Now look to your left of you and say, I gained the victory in 2026. Will you be with me?
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. Let me say to this freshman class, you have said that you have no intentions of cursing the darkness. You obviously know that the Bible has told us it is better to light a candle than to curse the dark. Since time immemorial, the greatest challenge that man has ever faced has been the challenge of overcoming self. Pogo has told us that we have found the enemy, and it is us. How can we know and be sure that you are not just another group of students who came here because your parents sent you, but you are here to equip yourselves to command your rightful place in the global society? How can we know that you are here because you have the financial aid to be here, or it was just another step after high school? How can we know this? Who will speak for this class? Come forward. Who will speak for this class?
I will speak for this class.
Come forward. Who will speak for this class? Come forth. Who will speak for this class?
I will speak for this class.
Come forth. Who will speak for this class?
I will speak for this class.
Come forth. Who will speak for this class?
I'll speak for this class.
Come forward. Who will speak for this class? Come forward. Who will speak for this class? Who will speak for this class? Come forward. Who will speak for this class? Come forward. Who will speak for this class?
I will speak for this class.
Who will speak for this class? Come forward. Who will speak for this class? Who will speak for this class? Come forward. Who will speak for this class? That's it. Okay. You are here before us right now. You said you will speak for this class, so now speak. Mike's not on.
So I therefore light this candle of love.
We are conscious of the plight of those around us. That is why we have come to gain the tools that we might be able to alleviate their distress. With this candle, we accept the light of compassion.
We will run this race with patience. We will be steadfast and immovable despite oppositions, difficulties, and adversities. We light this candle for tenacity.
We are told to seek after truth,
for when we find it, it will set us free. Truth may suffer to death, but it never dies. For my classmate, I light the candle of truth.
Justice is blind. If we know that we have justice, it will give birth to courage. For my class, I light the candle of justice.
Art is long, not life short. Practice not your art and it will soon depart. I light the candle of art.
We know that beauty is elusive, yet we must continue to remind ourselves that beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Beauty displays perfection. I light the candle of beauty.
We are too young to remember Martin Luther King, but our parents continue to remind us that much of what we take for granted today came at the price of his life. We do believe that people should be judged by the content of their character and not the color of their skin. Today, we light the candle of character.
When there is not equality, there will never be perfect love. We shall continue the struggle for equality among the people of the world. Thus, we light the candle of equality.
The search for knowledge is the search for truth. One author said, a little knowledge is a dangerous thing. Knowledge has no enemy but ignorance. Today, I light the candle for knowledge.
So, faith is a substance of things, hope for evidence of things not seen. We believe that faith can move mountains. So today, I will light the candle of faith.
Webster describes hope as cherishing a desire of expectations of fulfillment. We have come to reaffirm Jesse Jackson's admonitions to us. We have come to keep hope alive.
Scholarship will keep us honest. We will be vigilant, persuade of truth, remembering scholarship knows no national boundaries. Today, we light the candle of scholarship.
Today, we symbolically declare the beginning of our preparation of this class to accept the torch of leadership, which will be passed to them. In a world still full of ignorance, they have decided to light a candle rather than curse the dog. Remember the words of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., if a man hasn't discovered something he will die for, he isn't fit to live. And that injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Let's thank this class for declaring that they will not, that they will light a candle rather than curse the dog. Dr. Anthony Davis, would you come forward? We have said that we take our students where they are, and we take them where they need to be so that they can command their rightful place in the global society. At this time, I want to be able to make a special recognition and presentation, and I'm asking Dr. Anthony Davis to do so.
Dr. James Gavin was the founding chairman of the Partnership for a Healthy America, which produced all the national initiatives and national programs for Michelle Obama's Let's Move campaign. They dedicated their work to improving the health of American children and families. This organization has grown into one of the leading advocates for healthy lifestyles and nutrition, and is responsible for providing healthy meals to millions of families throughout the country, which was especially important during the severe pandemic that paralyzed this nation. Partnership for a Healthy America has honored Dr. James Gavin as Chairman Emeritus and dedicated a bench in his honor in front of the Success Center on the campus of Livingstone College. I think we need to give that a round of applause. This demonstrates loyalty, dedication of this notable alumnus to his alma mater. As we say, Livingstone graduates are resilient, relevant, and ready. And Dr. Gavin is a living logo of being a Livingstonian. At this time, we have a video presentation.
Hello, Dr. Gavin. It's Nancy, and I so wish I could be there in person to give you a hug and say thank you for your amazing leadership. I know this group knows you well and knows of many of your great accomplishments, but they probably don't know how instrumental you were in working with Michelle Obama to establish the nation's leading nonprofit working toward food equity, Partnership for a Healthier America. And they probably don't know the incredible things that have been accomplished. We have improved the quality of food in 1/3 of the nation's food banks, serving more than 7 million people. We've gotten millions of pounds of junk food out of the system, added millions of pounds of fresh produce into the charitable food system. We worked with Michelle Obama to distribute more than 1 million meals in Cleveland, Detroit, Philadelphia, Fresno, across the country. And we're working with more than 300 corporate partners to get salt, fat, and other garbage out of food. We live in a broken food culture where there's gross inequity in the quality of food across this country, but we are changing that. Your leadership and your legacy will continue on as PHA continues to do its amazing work. We cannot say how grateful we are for the 12 years of your profound and meaningful leadership.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's put our hands together for our very own Dr. James Gavin, who will come to the podium for brief remarks.
And I need to say to you this morning that the Partnership for a Healthier America wanted to place this bench at Emory University. But Dr. Gavin, who is a graduate of Livingstone College, insisted that the bench be placed at Livingstone College. So we're very proud of you.
President Jenkins, the chairman of the board, Bishop Monroe, to my fellow trustees, to the members of the faculty and staff of this great and beloved institution, to the guests who are here, and to our special guest and this inspirational speaker, Dr. Moss, who has really fired us all up and who has issued the kind of challenge that I heard and has helped to lead me into some of the kinds of activities that we celebrate at this moment. Let me thank you for this recognition. I am honored to have been a part of an effort that has really helped to change the lives of so many people in this country, to move us towards health. This is part of what Livingstone preaches, teaches, and it's what we must continue to do. I'm so happy that the college accepted the opportunity. Of course, it came with a donation, so I figured that it probably wouldn't be turned away. So thank you all. It's a pleasure to be here. I want to thank my dear wife, Dr. Ann Gavin, who has been right there and without whom none of this would have ever been possible. 57 years ago is where we met, right here at Livingstone College. So thank you. Thank you, Dr. Davis, for this opportunity and for this honor.
Now you can see what Livingstone produces. Clearly, he is the world's he's one of the world's foremost experts in diabetes, and he came from Livingstone College. So we're very proud of that as well. I want to call now Bishop Monroe, Kenneth Monroe, to the podium for his present, for his special presentation. Bishop Monroe, would you please come forward at this time?
Thank you, Dr. Jenkins, members of the Board of Trustees and faculty, staff, classes of 2023 and 2026. It has been my privilege to serve on four college boards as chairman. Chairman of the Board of Trustees at AME Zion University in Liberia, chairman of the Board of Trustees at Clinton College in Rock Hill, South Carolina, chairman of the Board of Trustees at Hood Theological Seminary, and now as chairman of the Board of Livingstone College. It has been my honor to do that. And I want to thank Dr. Jimmy R. Jenkins, Sr., for the outstanding leadership he's given to this college in the last 16 years. It was my privilege to be on the Board of Trustees 16 years ago. Dr. Jenkins was elected president. He came saying, "I come with a mission." And the mission might at that time seem impossible. But Dr. Jenkins realized the scripture that has been placed in my heart and mind for years, "I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength." He's done a marvelous job, and we are grateful for what he has done and what he will continue to do as he resides in Salisbury. But it is my privilege, after the search committee has worked very diligently seeking a person to move forward, take this school to its next level, we looked at more than 35 candidates, and it was a very difficult job. But it is my pleasure at this time, after a vote from the full Board of Trustees on yesterday, to announce the 13th president of Livingstone College, Dr. Anthony Davis. Would you please receive him?
Hold fast to dreams, because when dreams die, life is a broken winged bird that cannot fly. Hold fast to dreams, because when dreams go, life is a barren field frozen with snow. To Bishop Monroe, the chairman of the Board of Trustees and the senior bishop of the AME Zion Church, I thank you. To the members of the Board of Trustees, I thank you. To this giant gentleman and a genius, who I met 17 years ago when I sat as a member of the search committee executed by Bishop Walker. He said, "I'm not looking for a job, I'm looking for a mission." I think today, almost 17 years later, we can all agree, Dr. Jenkins, mission accomplished. Can we celebrate the work of Dr. Jenkins? Absolutely. I am filled with a number of emotions today. This is not an inauguration, inaugural speech. This is just a few remarks to just say thank you. But I have to say that I am happy, I'm honored, and I'm humbled. I'm happy because I've been selected to serve an institution. And again, that is my role, to serve an institution that has done so much for so many with so little. I'm honored, Bishop Monroe, and to this search committee that you selected me. A unanimous vote, thank you so much. But I realize that the mantle of leadership has been passed to my hands and I have large shoes to fill. But I'm honored that you selected me. I'm also humbled because individuals with my backstory normally don't have the opportunity like this one. See, at the age of 17 years, 8 months, I emancipated myself from the foster care system. In case you don't know what that means that when you're 18, they kick you out of the system with no resources. Only 3% of us who are emancipated go to college. Only 1% of us graduate. Less than 1% of us obtain a master's degree and an earned doctorate. And I must say, less than 1% of us are ever elevated to serve as a college president. Wow. To God be the glory. I'm grateful to so many people, and time will not allow me to call all of them by name. But to all the people who prepared me along my journey, to the people who pushed me, and more importantly, all of you who prayed for me, I want to say thank you and express my gratitude. I want to thank my wife of 34 years, soon to be Dr. Jacqueline Davis. I want her to stand and wave. 34 years. When people told her she was crazy for letting me travel all over the country to be what I was trying to be, thank you so much. To my children, you know, you teach them to be resourceful, Bishop. My baby boy had to go to work. He's at North Carolina A&T State University. He got off work, came here, but he had to get back. But he's working at North Carolina State, North Carolina A&T State University. Let me get it right, HBCU. He couldn't be here, but my oldest son, Brandon, is here. And go ahead and stand up, Brandon. He's a Livingstone graduate. And of course, it's just not fair, my baby girl, Maya Ashley Nicole Davis Esquire, my baby girl. As I close during my interview, I asked the search committee a question. I asked them, what do Patrick Mahomes, Tom Brady, and Aaron Rodgers all have in common? You know, Bishop Starnes being a football man, he said, great NFL quarterbacks. I said, you're right, but that's not the right answer. The correct answer is that they were all good backups waiting for an opportunity to get on the field to share their gifts with the world. I thank this board for giving me an opportunity to get on this field and share my gifts with the world. I can't wait to go to work. I can't wait to get to work. And I cannot wait to get the campus, the community, and the church working collaboratively as we advance the mission of this great institution where we produce graduates who are resilient, relevant, and ready. We don't have time to play the dream to drift. We have hard work to do and heavy loads to lift. Shun not the struggle. Let's face it, it's God's gift. God bless you all, and God bless Livingstone College. And I'm excited to serve as your 13th president.
Thank you, Dr. Davis. It is also my privilege to announce to this body that at the Board of Trustees meeting on yesterday, we named Dr. Jimmy R. Jenkins as an emeritus president of Livingstone College.
Thank all of you for joining us today, and special thanks to the Fall Convocation Committee for this program led by the vice, the senior staff here at the institution. It's been a great day, and it's a new day at Livingstone College, and we are poised to make a quantum leap into the future as this institution prepares for a leadership transition. The vision of the college and the success of its students will remain constant as Dr. Davis leads Livingstone College to greater heights. May God bless Livingstone College and Dr. Davis and his family. We will end our program by singing the alma mater, followed by the benediction by Bishop Dennis V. Proctor, presiding prelate of the Northeastern Episcopal District and a Livingstone College board member. We ask that you begin to do not exit, but wait for the recessional to move out. We're going to go over, and I hope you will join us over by the Success Center, where we will be able to witness the unveiling of the bench that was contributed by the Partnership for a Healthier America in the name of Dr. James Gavin. So that will be right after this program is over. It's goose pimple time. Join us in singing the alma mater and then the benediction after the alma mater. Stay with us.
Oh,
Please be seated. Let us receive the benediction. Again, we commend our convocation speaker for challenging and naming you the chosen generation. So our benediction, our final blessing, goes to you, the chosen generation. Gracious God, we have heard that because they are chosen, they will not be found wilding out, but fulfilling the ancestors' wildest dreams. We pray your favor and fortitude with them, that no matter what they encounter, no matter the size of the obstacle, they will always remember their God is greater. Give them now that which only you can provide, the anointing for the assignment. We ask it and believe it done. In Jesus' name, amen.